So you might be wondering, what AI do I use in 2025? If you've watched this channel before, you would know that I use large language models or LLMs in my workflow. You've probably tried ChatGPT or maybe Claude, but every day it seems a new model is coming out. We're moving towards an era where we'll not be just chatting with the model, but we'll be using it as an agent in our businesses. And these will supercharge our productivity. They'll be customized to our voice and our workflow. So I'm regularly being asked, what is the difference between these large language models? You will also have noticed that LLMs are starting to charge for their advanced features. And these paid subscriptions can range from around $20 on average to a mind-blowing $200 on ChatGPT's Pro version. So today I'm breaking down the large language models commonly used in businesses and whether it's worth paying a subscription or whether you should just stick to the free version. Firstly, you should know that free AI as we know it is unsustainable. A typical ChatGPT session costs money. It's estimated that a 10-minute ChatGPT session will cost around $16 if it lasts for 10 minutes and uses 1,000 tokens. Another scary statistic is that the servers that are used to run these queries need to be cooled down. And for a typical query, the amount of water that is used to cool these servers is around one bottle. The CEO of Anthropic said that to train a large language model is going to cost about $100 billion. So you can see immediately that they are running at a huge loss. And clearly it means that the free ChatGPT session that you've been enjoying is going to be a thing of the past. Now, there are many ways to monetize a platform like ChatGPT. They could run ads, which could be annoying, but if you kept the free functionality, then it might be worth. But the key takeaway here is, if you want to access the latest and greatest model, you're going to have to pay for it. So let's move on to the choices that you have. So let's check out this model from Information is Beautiful. I'll leave a link in the description if you want to look at it in more detail. In this graphic, the models were compared using what they call an MMLU rating, which basically means that they gave the model 16,000 multiple choice questions across 57 academic subjects. So as you can see, a human expert in these subjects got a score of 89.8. And you can see here that the new ChatGPT, so if you click on the things, you can see that the model that they've used and the MMLU score. And you can see here that it scored 92.3, which officially makes it better than a human expert in a subject. And if you have a look at all the dots, you can hover over them and see their performance in relation to this human expert. So if it's above 70, it's ideal. It means that the model has expertise in the subject. So the model that you're probably commonly using in ChatGPT, for example, is GPT-4, and you can see it's got an MMLU rating of 86.4, which is slightly below a human expert. But as you go on, you can see, for example, if you go into Claude 3.5 Sonnet, it has an MLU rating of 90.5. If you scroll down, you can also check out the LM Arena score. They have a leaderboard which is ranked by tens of thousands of users. So they don't have any Chinese models here, but you can see that Gemini 2.1 slightly edged out GPT-01. Now, if you don't know what all these models mean, I'm going to explain it to you now. By the current timeline, 01 is the best by both these metrics, slightly edged out by Gemini 2.0. So now that we've looked at all these models and the model names, what should you look for? I'm going to assume that you, like me, are running a business. I deal with a lot of interior designers as an interior design coach. So we have a few specific needs, which are quite common to most creative businesses. The first use case is to save us time. So we use AI to help us write emails, to help us write documentation, to create social media. The second use case is to enhance our client experience. So we might use AI in visualizations and also in project management. And the third use case is to grow our business. So to streamline our processes, to help with client communication, to create multiple design options quickly. So let's go over some of the most common models and tools that you might have heard of. As you probably are aware, the market leaders are OpenAI, which makes ChatGPT, and Anthropic, which makes Claude. If you're on a paid plan with these platforms, you'll be able to see and use different models depending on how much you pay. The latest OpenAI models that we touched on when we looked at the screen share is ChatGPT 4.0 and 0.1. Now, 4.0 is a multimodal model, and multimodal means it can take in information from multiple sources and create output also from multiple sources. So it can take information from text, from images, from sound, and it can do this in real time. And it includes Sora, which is OpenAI's video generation tool, which was released a few weeks ago. 0.1 is the most advanced model, and it focuses on reasoning. So that means maths type reasoning. With the basic plan, you get access to GPT-4 and limited uses of 0.1. If you're an interior designer like me, you might think, well, why do I need 0.1? It's for advanced reasoning and I don't use that. Well, here is an example where I wanted to know how much fabric I needed for a sofa. Now, obviously I could have a spreadsheet that would work it all out for me, but it's just so much easier to send ChatGPT a message and let it work it out. Now, you'll notice here that I asked it to tell me the formula so I can go through and check its work to ensure that it is a correct answer. And also in the future, if I wanted to take that formula and put it into a spreadsheet or use it in some other way or change the calculations, I can do that in the future. I was pretty happy with these results. If you're considering using ChatGPT, the plus plan for most used cases is as much as you would need. The $200 ChatGPT Pro plan includes much more access to 0.1 as a model, as well as access to more of Sora AI. So unless you're generating a lot of video or using ChatGPT within an organization, the $20 plan is more than enough. Let's move on to Claude. If you do a lot of writing in your workflow, Claude is great for this purpose. One of the things I love about Claude is its ability to train personas in a particular tone of voice. For example, the way that I use it is I create Instagram carousels and I use Claude, which I've trained as this marketing maverick where I've given some styles here. You can create and edit these styles and you can create as many custom styles as you want. And then I have actually trained the style. So I've actually renamed the style and I've edited it manually. So this has helped me a lot in terms of producing content for Instagram. The next model that you might come across is Google Gemini. A subscription here would be particularly useful if you use Google Workspace because it connects to all the apps that you use in Google Workspace, like Docs, Sheets, and so on. It can create multimodal content as well. And because it integrates directly into your Google Workspace, it's very, very easy to access. So if you use a lot of information in your business, Gemini might be something that's worth paying for. The next biggest one that you might come across is Llama. And Llama is made by Meta and it's open source. And because it's open source, you can download the code, but you need to have a very, very big computer with a lot of computing power. Otherwise, you'll have to run it on something on a cloud-based service like AWS or Google Cloud. And this can be a little bit difficult and expensive if you are running it. So it's probably only suitable for large organizations. However, Llama's model is used as the basis of quite a number of apps because of its ability to interpret things like voice. So it's used as the basis of Zoom AI, for example. Finally, let's talk about tools that are built on LLMs. So the two that you might have heard of is NotebookLM and Perplexity. NotebookLM is made by Google. It again integrates with Gemini and Google Workspace. And with NotebookLM, you can upload your own information and documents. So it means that if you're an interior designer, you have a lot of PDF, it could be price lists, it could be documentation for furniture, whatever. We deal with a lot of information. And what we can do is upload this information into NotebookLM, then be able to access that information by chatting with the notebook. It can even create podcasts based on the information that you have uploaded. For businesses, if you have a lot of information in PDFs, this could be the way to go. The free version, I think you're limited to 100 notebooks and you can upload 50 sources per notebook. But with the paid version, you can have as many as 500 notebooks and upload 300 sources. So it could be incredibly powerful. For designers who often have to access documentation, this would be very, very useful and save a lot of time, as well as having the ability to process that information right in the chat. Perplexity AI is a little bit different. I think of it as primarily a search engine. And so you would use it as a research tool that would give you accurate results based on the information that is found on the web. For example, imagine you were researching an eco-designed home. You could get Perplexity to research eco-friendly materials and floorings that are available in your area. You could ask it for inspiration in your country or in a specific area. You could generate a brief description for a client proposal. I've used it in quite an interesting way. Here's a use case. Let's say I liked this image and I wanted to create an image in Midjourney that was similar to this. I could, firstly, let me just take a screenshot. We could attach a screenshot, or we could actually even take a screenshot here. But let me just attach this screenshot. So here I've just said I'd like to create a prompt in Midjourney to describe this image. And you can see there's two stages. It's analyzing the image and generating a descriptive prompt. So what we can do is copy the prompt. And let's just hop back in to Midjourney. Let me just find it and paste in the prompt. So as you can see, we can, here is the generation. If we look at the original prompt, we can see it's got the tulips, it's got the console table, it's got the composition, and you know, it's actually pretty good. Now, I also did this prompt here. I got it to describe this image here, and we can see that when Midjourney created the image, this is what I got, which is actually so close to the original image. So this is the original image, and this is the new image that were created. So you can see, if you looked at them side by side, they are incredibly similar. So this is a photo from Architectural Digest. And this is one of the ones that was was generated in Midjourney, and you can see they are really, really, really similar. Now, obviously, there are some differences, and you could use Midjourney's re-edit tool to help you to change the details of the image if you would like, but it's actually really, really close. So that's my roundup of the LLMs that I think it's worth you to have a look at. But remember that AI is just a tool that will enhance your creativity. It won't replace it. But by incorporating these tools thoughtfully, you can spend more time on creating the things that you love to do. If you found this video helpful, do hit subscribe and let me know in the comments what aspect of AI you'd like to learn in interior design. I've also created videos in depth on Midjourney and how to use it in your interior design workflow. I'll leave a link up here. You can check it out. If you're finding this video useful, don't forget to check out my other videos on AI for interior designers. I'll leave a link to the playlist up here and you can check it out. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.